So I stated an important lemma about the prevalence between three different sigma algebras for any measure mu, which is invariant under this two-dimensional action on four-dimensional curves. And it is closely related to the entropy miracle that I've discussed in some detail. So basically, so here's a proof of this lemma. Maybe for notational convenience, I'll say this would be this, maybe this, this, and this, sigma algebra called D plus one, and then let's say Wi is the sum of the two Vj plus Vk, where J and K are the are J, K, and I together are a permutation of one to of plus minus 1, 0 plus. Okay, so this is a notation, and the particular example I chose of automorphism of a two commuting automorphisms of a four-dimensional torus with a central direction. There was somehow this example has two nice features. One of them is more important, and one of them is more visible. The more visible feature of this example is that there is an element which actually acts by isometries on one of the invariant foliations. If I chose, for instance, two commutative automorphisms on a three-dimensional torus, I could get things which act almost like an isometry on one of the foliations, but not quite exactly as an isometry. This was somehow the visible feature, simplifying feature, and the important simplifying feature is this thing that Uri asked about before the break, that I can find an element of the action which contracts any two of the, so for any I can find the element of the action which contracts Wi and expand Vi. So because of the particular example we chose, of our choice of V2 action to study, for every I, there is some element gamma and gamma such that which expands let's say Vi, and contracting the complementary subspace Wi. Therefore, we know, so what do we know by this entropy miracle? So we know that the sigma algebra of Vi invariant sets, and when I say sets, I emphasize I'm talking about Borel sets. So this sigma algebra, we said, is equivalent modulo mu to the sigma algebra of Wi invariant sets. But what's the relation between the sigma algebra of Wi invariant sets and the sigma algebra of Vj invariant sets for j not equal to I? So Wi is a two-dimensional space, Vj is inside it. So asking that you're invariant under a smaller group is a weaker assumption. Weaker assumption means that this sigma algebra is richer than this sigma algebra. So for every, so modeling the measure mu, for every I and j, the vi invariant sets are contained in the vj invariant sets up to measure mu. Of course, by symmetry, there's nothing special about choice of I and j, the vj invariant sets would be contained up to measure mu in the collection of the vi invariant sets. So, because this relation of if you have two sigma algebras which each one is contained in the other up to measure modulo and measure mu, then of course by definition this means that they are equivalent. So vi invariant sets, the sigma algebra of Borel sets which are vi invariant, is the same modulo mu as the vj invariant sets. Proving the fundamental, this important. So now I need to talk a bit about least wave measures. Suppose I have a measure, let's start with some measure. Let's not call it mu because mu would be this measure that we're thinking about. Let's find some other random Greek letter, maybe tau. So suppose tau is a measure on the unit square. Okay? Then I can write tau not quite a square. I can write tau as some kind of there will be some measure on the base and then measures on the fibers. I can write tau if I want as an integral of some measures for each point x. This is a point I have a delta measure at x times some measure on the fiber. Tau x is a measure. The way I wrote the tau x would be a measure on 0, 1, probability measure, with respect to some measure on the base, with tau x and new probability measures. Probability measures on the unit. Okay, this is well known. Now, suppose I have, and this is basically, and this, and tau x and nu are essentially easy. The only thing you can change your tau on a set of measure 0 and not a set of new measure 0 and not notice the difference, but except for that, you are your hands are tied. Slightly more tricky, not much. You can deduce one from the other. Let's suppose now I have a measure. Let's suppose now tau is only a locally finite measure. On R squared. And now I also want to decompose it. So you could still write, one can write tau in the same, exactly the same way, some fiber-wise measure. Let's say there is a probability measure on R. Nu is a probability measure on R. These targets are locally finite measures on R. But now this is not quite as canonical, this decomposition, as in the probability measure case, because basically because they have no real way of normalizing the measure towers. If tau is the integral of delta x times tau twiddle x, the new twiddle x is another such decomposition. Then what do we know? Then nu and nu twiddle are in the same measure class. They share the same null sets. And for new almost every x, the measure tau x would be some constant depending on x times tau twiddle x or some cx, positive real number. Now I want to apply this to construct some kind of system of measures on system of leafwise measures on the toes. So I'm going to construct, so we are going to use this decomposition. Construct for any measure, so this is somehow no automorphism, no action inside the moment for any mu on, let's say, TP and some subspace V, some linear subspace of RD. Measurable map, a Borel measurable map, if you like, from TD will be a slightly strange notation, call it mu xv. But this is just a function, right? X is my variable. From TD to some slightly exotic space, the space of measures. With some given gross condition on so locally finite measure with some given gross condition on V up to scalar. So what is the space again? So this is I leave this important lemma alone for the time being. So the space again is a space of equivalence class of measures where mu is a measure, is a locally finite measure. On V, and the integral of rho with respect to mu is less than, this is not mu. Tau, something. Integral with respect to tau is the integral of rho with respect to tau is finite, and I identify mu as identify two measures if tau is c tau prime for c positive.
What is rho?
Okay, rho is some positive function. Rho, here present notation, is a positive function. On Vn, for our purposes, let's fix V. Rho would be, for my purposes, a good choice would be 1 plus rho of V, rho of little v, is 1 plus norm of V to the dimension of V plus 1 or something like that. It's not exactly, it's not super important for us what rho is, but it is helpful to have these measures all satisfy some growth condition, because if you just look at the space of locally finite measures up to a constant without such growth condition, it is not such a nice space. It's sort of not so easy to find the reasonably good. It's not easy, maybe not possible, to give it the structure of a compact matrix space. Whereas this is naturally has the structure of a compact matrix space. So I have a measurable map here to the space, which will be constructed. So how do we construct this map? Here's the construction. So here's the construction. I need to give you a recipe, so take me on TV. Lift it to a VD invariant measure. This is a probability measure. Now this is, of course, an infinite measure. Mu tilde on RD. Okay. Now I have a measure mu on RD. Pick some complementary space for V. So I can write RD. I can write RD as V direct sum with some complementary space. Now I use this decompositional measure to decompose mu as integral over, I guess, V prime of, since I wrote it in this order, maybe right here, some measure multiplied by delta measure at y, d nu y, and y is an element of v prime. Okay, so let's do this exactly this construction. I have this is v prime, this is v, and I sort of have some, this is my base, and these are my files. Represent the measure this way. And then, so define, so if I have a point P inside TD, I want to define, so I want to define this conditional measure at P for V. This is by definition. So to define this, thing, find some point V, V prime inside my point P. So I have here this whole thing is, there's a project to the torus, I get some point P, there are many points I can list it. Upstairs, maybe one point will be VV prime. And I define this. I take the equivalence class up to multiplying by a constant of this measure mu tilde at V prime. But this is not well defined. If I choose a different pair, I will get a different value. So to get it to be well defined, and for this you use the invariance of mu tilde under ZD, I right translate it, I think, by minus B. Okay, so I take this measure on the fiber, I translate it so that somehow origin is moved to V instead of zero, and now this thing turns out to be well defined and turns out to have it's proposition, lemma, whatever, mu PV is well defined. Integral of rho in mu PV is finite almost everywhere. And if you want, you could choose it so that this is true forever. If you want, you could sort of say in a set of full measure. If I take the conditional measure, so if I have 2 points which differ on my toes, which differ by a translate in the V direction, the conditional measures would basically be one needs to see whether this is, I think this is little v. If I have 2 points which differ, if you have 2 points on the same orbit of this group V, I think of these as a foliation of the toe, so I have 2 points in the same leaf, the conditional measures would be the same up to this leaf with measures which are actually equivalence classes up to constant would be the same up to translation. Okay? So this is a nice construction. It satisfies, it has another nice feature. So maybe I'll add it to this proposition while I'm at it. Moreover, so this is continuation of this proposition. If I have some A gamma as some automorphism, and mu is gamma invariant, and V is fixed by gamma, is fixed by gamma. So gamma maybe acts in some way on V, not even way, but it fixes the space V. Then for almost every x, for mu almost every x, if I look at the slip rate measure at the point gamma p for v, this would be the same as gamma applied to the measure, leaf rate measure for mu at p. Okay, so this is all properties of this construction. All of these, this proposition follows quite easily from the construction I gave and from the universality properties of this decomposition, which are listed here and will be erased in a second.
How can you ensure that the empty integral is finite? I didn't understand. You say that the integral of this function rho is finite?
Almost surely, yeah. That's sort of slightly more delicate, but that's true.
hazelnuts.
It has been written in some, it's even written downwards, so it's not completely. No, but basically it's not, it's relatively, because your measure is gamma invariant somehow, right? So it's not going to...
Okay, you use gamma invariant.
Not gamma, because my measure is ZD, my measure mu
is
ZD invariant. I use it as ZD invariant, otherwise it's not true. But because it's ZD invariant, right, my measure on... So I start with an arbitrary measure on the
tone. Rho is not any function.
Rho is not any function.
Okay,
so I sort of chose, this is a particular choice which works. Anything which is sort of... this is a particular choice which works, and it works precisely because I start, okay, I start with an arbitrary measure on the torus, but when I lift it to RD, it's a measure which grows like Lebesgue measure somehow. And then somehow it guarantees this condition. It's sort of a nicety which we don't really have to bother about at the moment. It just allows me to think of this space as a nice metric space. I prefer to not to work with actual measures, but with equivalence class of measures. And if I have some kind of gross condition, any kind of gross condition on the measure, that's sort of a nicer space. Okay, so let's apply this. So in particular, let's apply this to gamma being my element A, and V being this isometric direction for A, this direction which A just rotates, but does not expand nor contract. B would necessarily, this was my claim for this, B would necessarily either expand or contract this direction. But A in this direction just neither contracts nor expands. Okay? So I get, what do I get? I get a factor map from TD, my measure mu, and the action by A, multiplying by A, and of course, this is Borel sigma algebra. So this map is. F is simply the map, this conditional expectation map we discussed, this three-point measure map we discussed. So the space is this space, nice space of function with some given gross condition on V. Measure is whatever the push forward of the measure is. And the action, what would be the action? The action is rotation by theta, it is the I theta would be an eigenvalue of A. So rotation by theta and, okay, appropriate sigma. You could imagine some kind of coordinate system you could give. So you could give, here's a nice coordinate system you can give to this space. You could take maybe, polynomials up to a certain degree. Integrate maybe a polynomial of degree. One sort of coordinate system would be to take some kind of basis of polynomials up to degree d, and then integrate this polynomial if we put some appropriate power of rho, so that this would have to converge, d with respect to your measure mu v, and then divide it to make everything by the integral of rho or integral of rho to the m or whatever you want to normalize to make sure it's not would be invariant under scaling of mu. And this would be a nice coordinate system for my space. So basically, and in this coordinate system, basically you see that this rotation by theta, you could divide your space into your coordinate system into finite dimensional parts, and each of which is rotation by theta is actually a rotation in the, it's actually applying some unitary matrix. So this is, this whole space, which okay, it's sort of a complicated space, space of measures, but basically this is just a fancy rotation. So this is a fancy rotation.
So what is the definition of F? I mean, what is the upper A mean?
So I take this conditional measure for this isometric direction for A. The upper A will just, because it's an isometric direction of A. Actually, I mean, I sort of like this call it to be zero.
Or even V. Or even V.
Or even V, yeah. But V0 is sort of really... V0 is good enough. I had this V0, V plus 1, V minus 1. I had this in the previous one. But anyway, this is a fancy rotation. Important thing about rotation, well, there are many things about rotation, but one nice thing, one feature of rotation is, of course, that they don't have any entropy. So this factor map has zero entropy. So this factor map has zero entropy.
Excuse me, and theta is exactly this rotation that A does in V.
Yes. So this factor map has zero entropy. Okay. Now, we said, so, we identified between the past sigma algebra, as we identified between past sigma algebra, between somehow this past scale, let's say for A, and the what's called the Pritzker algebra for A, and the maximal zero entropy, zero entropy sigma algebra for A. And we identified between the past tail for A, we identified with the V plus invariant sets. So basically, our entropy discussion, by the entropy discussion, for the action of A, extended, the discussion to be completely understood only by hyperbolic matrices, but extended to the non-hyperbolic case, which is not particularly complicated in this case. So by the entropy discussion extended to the non-hyperbolic case, we see that we conclude we change colors just because this pen seems to be dying, but no, this is the same sentence. We conclude that there will be some set X prime inside X of full mu measure. If I have 2 points, X and little X and little X prime are both inside X prime, and I can write X prime to be X plus. So if you remember, this discussion set, which differ only by the unstable for A, so this is X prime inside. So they'll differ by the other element of the unstable for A. So basically, this is exactly the same, like we said, that they would be in some finite tail from each other. This was then f of X prime is f of you like, or F is measured with respect, or equivalently, F is measurable with respect to the V plus invariances. Okay, so far, so good. We haven't even used the fact that we have a multi-parameter action. But now we know, now by cause action is because of the important lemma, in this phrase here that I have, we can replace in the signature, the sigma algebra of sets which are invariant under V plus are the same as the sigma algebra of sets which are invariant under V zero. So because of the important lemma, we can replace. So we can replace this condition, V plus A with V zero A. In stars. Of course, this requires choosing a different set X prime of full different X prime of full measurable truclets. So now we are almost done. Let's see what we have here. So I have the set X prime inside T4, right? So, and I can look, okay, this is sort of a big set, and I can, if you wish, you could sort of lift it upstairs to lift it to R4, and basically what you by the construction of these leafwise measures, for almost every, for mu, almost every x, I take a random point x in T4. For mu x v naught, almost every v in v, the point x plus v would be inside x prime. Okay, this is just expresses the fact that these measures were constructed from this decomposition of a measure mu or upstairs on R4. And if you keep track of the various translations we did back and forth, this is exactly what you would get. There's no, this is tautology. But now, because by star, by this statement there, we also know that we know that for mu x v naught, almost every v in v, in v naught to be precise, f, this f which is just mu of x plus v v naught, could be equal to mu of x v naught. But this is the same as a translation by v of my measure mu x v naught, because of by v or by minus v, I forgot now, because of this compatibility conditions between the leaf width measures on the same leaf of the foliation. Now, let's be a bit careful about reading this equality. This is not, so I've been a bit lazy here. These measures, I sort of made a point that they're not measures, are in fact equivalence class of measures up to a constant. Okay? So this is equivalence up to a constant. So in fact, this the only thing I really know, if we take a representative, so this is an equivalence class of measures. If we take a representative, which is an honest measure, the only thing I know about this honest measure is that if I translate it, I get the measure I started with times a constant. Okay? But because of my growth condition, my measures do not go exponentially, they go at most polynomially. I didn't prove it, but I said it. The measures grow at most polynomially. Okay? So because of the growth condition on the measures, this is exactly fine point, so let me write it down. Thus, if tau is a measure, this is actually a measure with this on this space, such that mu x v naught is the class of tau, the up to the constant times, is one of the measures which are constant times tau, then if I translate tau by v, this would be some constant times tau. As the integral with respect to tau of 1 over 1 plus v time, anything, in this case it's 3, but whatever, some polynomial bound is finite, tau cannot go exponentially, so c has to be equal to 1. So actually, we have actual invariance. So having a measure, so for almost every x, mu x plus v v naught is invariant mu x or v naught is invariant by translations by mu x v naught almost every v in v naught. Now if I have a measure which is divided by translation by almost every element, and not so many measures of this, basically this means that this measure is harmless. So this mu x v naught has to be our measure on some subgroup of v naught. And from here, there are several ways to continue, but basically, either those subgroups of the complex plane, additive subgroups of the complex plane, basically they are either just zero, or they are unbounded. So basically, either this group, this subgroup, is unbounded, it's also locally finite, this measure, so this is actually, right, this is actually a closed subgroup. Right, this is a closed subgroup. My measures are locally finite, so this should be a closed subgroup, not something strange. So either the subgroup is unbounded, and then, okay, there are sort of 14 different ways to conclude that the measure is the big measure, or the subgroup is just zero. Now, if the subgroup is zero, if mu n pi ergodicity or something, this would be the same for almost every point. So if this is zero, is the delta measure, is the equivalence class of delta measure zero, almost surely. Then, in fact, one can show it's rather easy than there's a sigma algebra of V0 invariant sets is the same up to measure zero to the sigma algebra of all sets, Borel sets. Basically, so what does this mean that this Lefort measure is zero? It basically means that on every leaf of the foliation into V0, in every leaf, there's only one point which is important for the measure. So, okay, this needs an argument, but you see that if on every leaf there's only one point that's invariant, one point that's important somehow, if you take any Borel set, and you take its saturation by adding to it bigger and bigger balls in V0, okay? So this would be, you take this union, you get a Borel set, and this Borel set would be equivalent up to null sets to the set you started with. And then again, if the sigma algebra of V0 invariant sets is everything, then the sigma algebra of V plus invariant sets is everything. So, I guess for any VI, VI invariant sets is everything. For every I, so this means that for any gamma, the entropy is zero. The entropy of mu is zero. So every gamma, we can identify the Pinsker sigma algebra of gamma with one of these sigma algebras of invariant sets. And we know that any factor map which is measurable with respect to the Pinsker sigma algebra with the tail sigma algebra has to have zero entropy. So in particular, our factor map here is a trivial map, identity map, so the whole thing would have zero entropy. And this concludes the proof of this particular case of the classification of measures on the toes, and this, okay, so this proves this particular case. This is a theorem of Katok and Spatzier. This proof, while not exactly the proof given by Katok and Spatzier, is not far removed from it. So now I have, I believe, about 10 minutes. Let me say a few things about homogeneous spaces. Any questions about this proof? I finished the proof. The good thing about finishing the proof also is that it's a good time if you want to resynchronize with the talk, because I'm starting from more general level. Indeed, I don't have time to go into more detail, so I did want. So now let's look at another example. Now I'm really going to look into sort of quotient of non-trivial algebraic groups. G would be S into R modulo times S into R. Gamma in G would be an irreducible lattice. I would have the group A1, which is diagonal in the first component, 1 in the second. A2 is a group which is identity in the first component, diagonal in the second component. Both of these are rank 1 diagonalizable group. A would be the group A1, A2. And what I would like to understand, so here's again exotic conjecture. If mu is A invariant and ergodic measure on G mod gamma, then G is homogeneous in the sense of Ratner, as in Ratner's theorem. Which in this particular case means, because the only options in this case are.
Elon, you meant to write mu is homogeneous.
The only options in this case are either mu is periodic under A, or mu is half on G. This is a conjecture, and in analogy to some extent with the theorem of Rudolph, so the theorem here, that let's say that if mu in addition satisfies H mu A 0 for some A, then actually mu is half. Now, let me define a few more groups. So I can define so these are four groups. I would be one or two. And there's a choice of signs. I'm defining four groups at once to save myself a minute. So this is this, for instance, is a group 1, 1, T, 1, 1, T now. The minus sign means I'm taking the same, but I'm taking T on the other side. And then changing the second index from 1 to 2 means I'm looking at the second component. Okay, so I define four groups. The same entropy, the same sort of entropy argument shows that the sigma algebra course, it's a bit different because I'm working not on a total homogeneous space, but variations are very minor. But the sigma algebra of U plus I invariant sets is equivalent mod mu to the sigma algebra of U minus I invariant sets for the same I. And this is closely related to what Manfred was mentioning at the end of his previous talk, that if you have a measure which is, let's say, even invariant under U plus 1, let's say if it's invariant under U plus 1, then saying on a set that it's invariant under U plus 1, because somehow the measure sees all points in this orbit is a very strong condition, then this means something about how the measure behaves in the U minus direction. In fact, means something in this, in the case that Manfred was talking about, means something means that you actually have to be invariant under the U, in the U minus direction. But there is no connection, but there's no reason I can see, but there's no a priori. The good thing about writing in English with connected letters is that nobody can actually prove that you've misspelled the word. So, anyway, there's no a priori reason for relation between these algebras for different types. And somehow this breaks, this causes the whole scheme of proof that I showed you to break down, unless you make some rather, some not quite natural assumptions, basically forcing it to work. Let's see how I can try to compress the... You could see that in some sense this is a bit more delicate, this theorem, than the case of the total. So there's sort of something slightly delicate here in that it is quite crucial that gamma be an irreducible lattice. Because if gamma was a reducible lattice, if gamma was some gamma 1 times gamma 2, then certainly there are a lot of measures with positive entropy on this product. You can just take a positive entropy measure on one and a positive entropy measure on the other. The whole, so something a bit more delicate is happening because the structure of gamma somehow enters into the picture. This is not just going to be a local type argument. And the key player here, I'm not going, I was planning to explain the proof, but of course I'm not going to have time, that's not a big surprise. But a key role here, so that this map, so the map, this factor map even, f of x is, let's say, mu x for one of them on this, let's say, u plus one. This factor map will play, does play a major role in the proof. But in fact, I look at it as a factor map, but basically we look at it as a factor map of the action of A. So A acts on, it's certainly, if I apply some element of A, then F, you could understand that F of A of X would be some dilation of the measure at F of X. So it is certainly a factor map for the action of A, but actually use it as a fact. But it's also true that if I look at two points which differ, two reasonable points which differ by an element of the U plus 1, then there would be some compatibility condition between these two points. I actually look at it as a factor map of the action, but of the action, I put it in quotes because it does not preserve the measure of u plus one, and then you use basically after some non-trivial modification, you use ideas of Ratner for explaining factors of essentially the whole cycle flow. The same arguments that Marina used to understand factors of the whole cycle flow can be used here. Okay, so I ran out of time, but this is a good place to stop. Thank you.
Any questions? If not, let's thank for the opportunity.